just can't find the right touch for turning you on. All the words are the ways that could make you love me. The ways of the soul. In search of a feeling that never was there, I went out of my way to go out of my mind.
Everybody, just a couple of hey, welcome. Just a couple of housekeeping announcements before we get started. Now would be the time to silence your cell phones, turn off the flash on your camera if you would. If you want to tell your friends to tune in, we're going to be streaming live at countrymusichalloffame.org. The emergency exits for the Ford Theater are in the back and or over here to your right. Also, just a little heads up, we do have our next Nashville Cats program confirmed, and that is going to be November 16th featuring Kenny Loveless. But today, we are super excited to get started with our Robby Turner program, and I would like to introduce you to the host today. Please welcome Peter Cooper.
Hey, y'all, thank you so much for being here. Welcome to the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum. Welcome to this beautiful Ford Theater. So many people have been on this stage that are important and meaningful and big deals to us, and we got another one coming up. Welcome to an explication and a celebration of the decades of meaningful and important work, though he'll say it's not work, it's play, of Nashville Cat, Robby Turner. No, we're not done. The guy's waited so long for his time in the spotlight. He's just chomping at the bit. Let's please recognize some other Nashville cats that are in this room. We have Richie Albright here. And we have the sheriff, Jimmy Capps, here. He was just backstage eating all the sandwiches. We have Sonny Garish, steel guitar great here. And we have my dear friend and the very first person that was recognized by this museum as a Nashville cat, Lloyd Lamar Green. Y'all, we sometimes speak of music as a universal language. But it's way, way better than that. Language involves an attempt to approximate fantasy and reality and emotion. And music gives us those things directly. It's not an approximation. You don't have to speak music in order to understand music. It goes straight from your ears to your heartstrings. Language is a derivation. Music is the source. And Robby Turner is an eloquent musical dude. He's been playing since he was a child. He's worked with the greatest of the great, and they have praised him for allowing them to expand and enable the sounds in their minds. Robby Turner solves puzzles with a smile at every session. Robby Turner is a Bible-abiding outlaw. He can turn between aggression and beauty on a dime. Robby Turner is a gentle instigator, and he's a bridge between heroes of the past, including Waylon Jennings and Johnny Cash, and heroes of the present, Chris Stapleton, Jim Lauderdale, Sturgill Simpson. Robby Turner plays steel guitar and most anything else that you'll need him to play. And after today, he's available, and he's in the union book. Robby Turner is the newest honoree in the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum's Nashville Cats series. Please welcome him. Ladies and gentlemen, Robby Turner. Okay, now, yeah, you can come out. It's cool.
Go back and try it again.
Robby, who were your parents?
Doyle and Bernice Turner. My dad was Doyle Turner, used to play steel guitar, and my mom, Bernice Turner, played rhythm guitar.
And, they ever play with anybody significant?
No. No, my dad had his own Western swing band for years, but from 44 to 46, they worked with Hank Williams Sr. in Montgomery, Alabama at WSFA radio station and some shows around Montgomery, local shows.
Hank Williams Sr., he was a musician of note.
Correct, yes, yeah. Not an in-law, but an outlaw.
Man, what did they say about him? What did they tell you about him?
Well, my father later would take a drink, but at the time he wasn't much of a drinker, and he said Hank was. And Hank was a fighter, but Hank was a great talented man, and they respected the talents. My mother stayed in touch with Audrey until her passing, but there were some good stories. One about my father, when Hank would sometimes not make the gig, he passed out in the back seat, and they'd go ahead and play without him. And one time he came in and got on stage. I think he had one boot on and his hat and his guitar, and he got up there and called one song and started singing a different one and playing it in a different key. And my dad hollered out an old song, I think Blue Steel Blues, and Hank turned around, gave him a dirty look, and just walked back out of the car and went back to sleep. There was many times like that, I believe.
Why did Hank employ your folks? What was it that was special about their musicality?
Well, Don Helms had got drafted in the Army.
And Don Helms, who was Hank's guitar player.
Right. And he ran into my folks at a street dance in Panama City where my father's from. And so he told him there's a young boy in Montgomery that's, he said he drinks a little bit, but he's a really a good country singer and writer.
Did you grow up loving Hank Williams?
Oh, yes. Yes, I mean, he was one of the greatest writers of all time, I think. His lyrics and honest songs, and I think he was probably the original outlaw.
And Don Helms, who was playing with him, as I guess your dad did, played pre-pedal steel. We talk about pedal steel guitar. What's the difference?
A whole lot of headaches.
Yeah, it's like at some point somebody took one of the most complicated instruments that there is to play and made it much more complicated by putting rods and pedals and
exactly.
Knee levers.
My dad played left-handed and backwards. He he borrowed a guitar from his cousin when he was a kid, 12 years old. His cousin said, "I know you're left-handed, you can't change the strings." So he just flipped the guitar over. So when I wanted to learn chords, I had to stand on my head on the guitar. But he played steel the same way, so he just turned it around. And I believe multi-chord was probably one of the first. I know Bigsby made pedal steels, but multi-chord made the single neck for the basic E9 thing. And my father, I believe, offered him quite a bit of money back when they first came out with pedals. And they said, "We can build you one left-handed, but not with the strings backwards." And so my dad just stayed with non-pedal steel until I shot Jackson. I had shot to build him one in the 70s.
Steel guitar was not your first instrument. Did your parents push you to play? Were you a willing accomplice?
Yeah, they didn't have to. I loved music. I loved the Beatles, and my dad instilled Western swing in me, and I heard an album that changed my life was the Ray Price Nightlife album. And my mother had that, and I would ask her if I could play it on the turntable. We had an old tube console turntable, and I would go in there and listen to that album just over and over again. And that's, I probably was 6 years old, 5 or 6. That's not my cell, is it? Somebody's calling. Something's coming in.
Yeah, you tried to come out too early, and now your cell's going off.
Yeah, I know.
This is a disaster.
I can't find a place to put my arms. I know now why they had that. Yeah. So, the nightlife. And I loved country music from childhood, and then I started playing drums with my folks' band when I was 6. My parents had been out of the music business, and they started playing an AA dance in Memphis, a place called the Action Club. And they needed a drummer. Right there, it's me. Wow, I was pretty. That's a good ad for Fender, too, isn't it? I didn't know they made drums. So I started playing drums in my folks' band when I was 6, my dad's band, which he played nothing but Hawaiian and Western swing, which was great. But I knew, not because he played it, but I loved pedal steel. I knew that one day that's what I wanted to do, even though it's a complicated instrument, a lot of headaches.
Well, it is a complicated instrument, and you're playing drums, and kids, I got a kid, and he likes drums. You can bang on it, and it, you know, gives you a satisfying, resonant, you know, sound that's annoying to your parents.
But you have to progress on to a musical instrument, though, at some point.
That's right.
Yeah. No, that's for Richie Albright. Well, yeah, Richie.
But steel guitar is so complicated. It's like doing calculus as David Letterman said to you, it's like flying a helicopter. Why would you be drawn to something so hard, so young?
I can fly a helicopter. No, I really can't, not at all. It's fascinating. It was soulful. I know that that whole album, everything on the Nightlife album, I remember thinking how the steel carried on like a vocal as far
You're
as
talking
the
about the Ray Price
Ray album. Price yeah. Nightlife album, yeah. And I remember every song had so much steel in it, and it seemed like it was so soulful. I believe Buddy play on Nightlife, and the rest of the album was Jimmy Day, is that right?
No.
Wrong. Who was it?
Little Billy Gilman.
Who played on the rest of the Nightlife album? Am I wrong? Somebody said. Okay. Well, anyway, like I said, but
we have every steel guitar player in the world here in the audience.
Yeah, I figured I'd get a front row answer
and
there.
And they're here to argue with us.
Yeah. But I remember it was such a soulful instrument, and I could hear heartache, you know, and I could feel the soul of the player and whoever was playing on Nightlife and the rest of the album. It just seemed like it just so laid back and flowing, and what I wanted to do one day.
I want to play everybody a recording from you when you were very young with your dad. This is Release Me, and let's play it for folks and then have you explain what this is. This is remarkable to me.
I have found a new love, dear.
What would I have done without strings 5, 6, and 8?
I'll cry on steel guitar.
Show me this. Play a 1/5. Thank you so much. That brings back many memories. And
how old were you?
I was 11 months old. No, I was 12 at the time, and I just got this Showbud Professional from Scotty. And like I said, if it wasn't for strings 5, 7, and 8, I don't know what I'd have done. But I've been playing probably less than a month, I believe.
It's incredible to me. I mean, for the steel guitar is the most difficult of country music instruments to play. And there's a reason when you go see some hot contemporary country singer, and there's all these people up, and you know they got lots of hair gel and cool outfit, and they're doing a whole lot of this. And then there's one person who looks like he sold insurance to the rest of the band.
Making faces, you know.
And he looks like he's taking the SAT. He's so serious in that. Yet you.
Well, he is in a way.
Explain that. What's so hard about it? Why is it? So, I guess what I'm asking you is to humble brag, which is, why is it so amazing that you were able to do that just a couple months into?
Did you just hear what I heard? No. I mean, when I listen to it in context, I can smile and the memories. My dad was trying to teach me. That's the way we would learn, because he said, go back and listen and learn what to improve. Well, there was a lot of improvement to that I needed to do. But I pretty much learned to play in D, for that. And learning things, but there's so many different positions, but there's a lot of things that the mechanics of the instrument, the temperament of it, the thirds alone, the third string and the sixth string are different beasts, but it's the desire of the heart. You know, if you have a desire of the heart, and I had that, I truly did. So I practiced every day. I would get up early before I went to school, and I'd practice and then go to school and come back and practice until bedtime, because I loved it that much. So, but it's a combination of all of that stuff that makes it hard. It's like any other instrument, really. I mean, there's nobody has learned everything that could be learned on the instrument. No one person, except Lloyd Green, and Sonny, and everybody else here. Bruce, but anyway, there's this endless possibilities what you could do, and there's so many different ways to do the same thing, and depending on positions and stuff. So, but the main thing was, like I said, it affected me. Why I wanted to play was from the soul, because it really, Jimmy Day, boy, just he was Mr. Soulful Steel, and I was good friends with him. I loved him to death, and I watched him play. That's me and him. And I watched him play one night. There's a story about
that.
That
was when you guys were doing the dancing competition.
We were slow dancing, yeah, to I'm Not Lisa, I believe. there's a story there. I ran into Jimmy. I met him at Showbud and ran into him. He was living in his car behind... He wasn't having a great run. He was living in his car behind Demon's Den, and he had a four-door Chevy, blue Chevy, and he had kept his cooler up in the front seat, and he slept in the back seat. And so After finding that out, I told my mother, I said, my mother always kept my money. I said, give him a couple of $100, you know, or give it to me, let me give it to him. So I gave it to him, and he didn't want to take it, but I made him take it. And so I was working for a guy named Ace Cannon. I think I was probably 15 years old, maybe 16. I think I was 15. I don't think I was driving yet. And so I was working for Ace Cannon in Memphis, and so we'd been to Nashville. So on the trip back, I was thinking, what could I do? Jimmy's not really working a lot, just playing the local, you know, Merchants and Demon's Den, the Wheel and stuff. So I got back, and there's an Elvis impersonator that had offered me a job playing bass. He loved my bass playing. And he offered me more money than I was making with Ace. And so I took I said, if I take that job, I can give you my job with Ace. And so when I got back, I called Ace, and I called Bill Haney first, and the offer was still on. And so I told him I'd be coming to work, and I told Ace, I said, I got good news and bad news. I said, what do you want first? He said, I want the bad news. I said, well, I'm quitting. And there wasn't a lot of steel players in Memphis. And I said, but the good news is I've got you a replacement for me. He said, who is it? I said, Jimmy Day. He said, I can't afford Jimmy Day. I said, yes, you can. And so I called Schott and said, Schott, give him enough money for him to get to Memphis. And Schott had a few choice words to say about it, because him and Schott had a history. But Schott always loved and helped everybody out and helped Jimmy out. But so anyway, I said, I'll pay it back. And I went to a club owner there and paid two or three months rent on an apartment, not an apartment, a hotel room. He owned a Motel 6 or Motel Super 8, Motel 6 or something. So anyway, he gave me a real good rate, you know, like $6 or $7 a night to pay in advance. So I paid Jimmy for a room, and Jimmy came to Memphis. What I got out of that, so I gave him my job, and he got back on his feet, which was it was good to see him do that. And Jimmy he told me one time, he said, after that, I never was lived in my car again. But every Wednesday night at my studio in Memphis, Sonic Studio, we would have a jam session. And so he played bass, had both steels set up, had my bass and my bass amp, and we'd get a drummer to come in. Sometimes just give him $20, buy him some beer or something, you know. Drummer would come, and we'd have jam sessions. And Jimmy played I'm Not Lisa. He just started playing it in F one night. And I would sit on a stool in front of him with the bass. And by the time it got to the end of the third line of the verse, starts off with the chorus, you know, we played that. And by the time it got to the third line of the verse, I had to stop playing bass. I was in tears. It was so soulful. It just grabbed my heart. And so I realized then, and I had been practicing my fast picking, you know, and trying to be clean and stuff. I realized then it's not how many notes you play, it's how much you get out of one note. And I'm still learning that. But I told Jimmy, I said, you know, I just got it. And he looked up and smiled, them old crooked teeth is part of them missing. But he knew it. He knew he'd played the devil out of it. And just beautiful. It was angelic. I couldn't play bass to keep up. So anyway, that picture where he's hugging me was at the Texas Steel Guitar Show probably 15 years later, maybe a little bit longer. And he come up and he said, you know, he remembered, he said, you did get it that night. He said, you play like me with your pedal rods going through your heart. And so I thought that was probably one of the best compliments to anybody. I don't agree that I always do that, but that means more to me, soulful, being soulful and whatever. But anyway, I love Jimmy a lot.
He was a great. Hey, we haven't established where you were coming from with all this. We talked about where you were coming from with your parents,
Paragould. Where I'm coming from?
Paragould, Arkansas. Okay. Which is what and where and what was that like?
I started playing steel when we lived in Paragould. We lived on a farm. We moved from Memphis for a short while. Lived in Paragould and Jonesboro, and then moved back to Memphis. So this was in Memphis. This is when we had moved back to Memphis from Jonesboro, but Paragould was where I was living. We had a house trailer on a 70-acre farm, which was funny, me being on a farm.
The one time I've been to Paragould, I was aware that it was only so far from Memphis, but it felt like a million miles from
yes,
Memphis.
Yes, yes. My father had played around there. He had, with his Western Swing Band, he had radio stations, had radio shows at KBOA in Kennett, Missouri, and KLCN in Blytheville, and he worked the Boot Hill there and played places like the American Club in the Boot Hill, and then he played a place in Paragould called Shorty Hyde owned it, called the 25 Club, and I played that same club myself when I was young, with, you know, played with his band and others while we lived at Paragould. But, so yeah.
And so, as a teenager, you're playing in Memphis a decent bit, and as I understand it, you ran into this cat named Jerry Lee Lewis. At a show.
I'm a Jimmy Jim, my mother hump, a cock, I wrote you down in Louisiana where the girls are hot, their mother hump, a big and rocking. Yeah, Jerry Lee. I first met him when I was 8 years old. I was playing with a group called the Penny Brothers from Paragould, Arkansas. And
would be laws against any 8-year old meeting Jerry Lee.
Well, there was a St. Jude benefit that was at, and Jerry Lee was the headliner at the Vapors Club in Memphis, and we were too young. The whole band was to be there, the oldest member. Is Steve Penny here? Steve was, okay, maybe he didn't make it, but Steve was supposed to come from Tupelo, but Steve was the oldest one. I think he might have been 15 or 16. And I was 8 playing drums with him, and I just started with him. So we played the benefit show earlier that day. Well, Jerry Lee got there. We set it up to get a picture taken with him. And I went back and met Jerry Lee. He said, how old are you, little killer? And I said, 8 years old. He said, let me give you some words of wisdom to go back and tell your teacher at school. And I can't repeat it. Not here. But I can tell you it was funny stuff. But anyway, yeah, and so I got to know Lee Lewis. In this picture right here, I was playing with Jerry J, and we was playing a club called the Traveling Fox. And it was Jerry Lee's birthday, and his organization had bought him a fiddle. Now you see what he does to pianos, and he's got a fiddle, and that was real nice. He had no idea how to tune it. And I'm not saying anything, but Jerry Lee's one of the most talented people ever. I mean, I love his rock and roll stuff. I love his the Jerry Kennedy records were some of the greatest ever. What made Milwaukee famous? Wow, that's country music. Another place, another time. And but fiddle, not at all. And he had it, but at least he had it through a PV amp. I think one of my Session 400s he was playing through, and so it was blasting. At least it was loud. So that was, that was from his birthday party there. And I've been playing a 4-hour gig. I started at 9 o'clock, and this was probably 3 o'clock in the morning. And that fiddle, I'll never forget it. But I played with Jerry. He would call me to play after I played a place called Bad Bob's in Memphis. It was my sit-down gig, 5 or 6. And I took Charlie Owens' place when he went to work with Freddie Hart. And I think I was maybe 12. And so I started playing that club regularly. And so when I'd get off at 1 o'clock in the morning, you know, before one, we get a call from Choctaw Lounge, a little hole in the wall where you'd walk in there, Charlie Rich would be drunk playing. This before he got hot again, you know, he'd be playing pinball, you know. But this place, the band started about 1 or 2 in the morning and played to about 6 or 8. And so Jerry Lee would call him, tell a little killer to bring his steel down here. And he always give me money for coming down. My mother would sleep in the car. And she'd drive me down there, and I'd take my steel in and pick with him. And one night he sat at my steel, not for long. but he didn't make a sound with it. But anyway, yeah, I never would tour with him. And I played some of his records. But I didn't care about going out of town. Kind of wild. And that fiddle.
So early on, you're playing a lot live on stage, and there are a lot of steel players who would rather just be in the studio and not be on stage. It is such a complicated
instrument, it's so easy to make little mistakes that steel players hear and others don't. But you, it seems like you took to the stage and enjoyed that.
I did. It was part of my learning process. I mean, I had to. I wasn't going to just fall right in the studio. Pete Drake, I used to, my mother would take me by there and just drop me off at Pete's place. And Pete would always, talk to me, spend time. And sometimes he'd be producing. I remember walking in that control room, and it looked like worse than any bar I'd ever seen as far as the thickness of cigarette smoke, you know. But Pete was a great guy.
And Pete Drake, for folks who don't know, played on, you know, a preponderance of George Jones hits and Tammy Wynette things, and he was Billy Sherrill's go-to guy on steel. He's somebody who goes down in history.
When I was younger, Lloyd Green and Pete Drake owned the radio, and you would hear Weldon, and you would hear Buddy, you know, and you'd hear Hal play on Loretta's stuff, but it was most, the majority of the stuff was, I'm not just saying it because Lloyd's here, because Pete's not, but Pete, but they really owned the radio. I mean, it was like just everything was, they worked all the time and made a lot of records. But, Pete asked me when I was 12, what do you want to be, a session guy or a road player or play with an artist live? And I never had thought of that. I'm 12 years old, you know. And I said, I said, this doesn't involve wife and kids, does it? And, He said, think about that, and next time I see you, answer. So I thought about it, and next couple of months when I was back down there, he said, you know, you told me to think about something, reminded me of it. He said, yeah. I said, well, what's your decision? I said, I want to be able to do both. I want to play on records, and I want to produce records. I knew then, at 12, that I wanted to overproduce records and engineer. I've had recording equipment since I was 9 years old. And so I said, I want to do a little of both, but I really want to concentrate on studio stuff.
Hey, I think we have a recording of you overproducing yourself as a young teen when you had not had recording equipment for very long. Can we hear a little bit of that? This is Robby playing everything that you hear. That was Pete Drake.
That was a few months later after the recording with my dad. Yeah, I had a four-track machine that didn't have a sync head, so I'd have to record on two of the tracks and put it on another two-track and play them back and play along with those and keep doing that until the tape quality fell off. But, that was me attempting to play everything.
Scotty's Music in St. Louis, an important place that steel guitar players know about, and people who aren't steel guitar players probably don't. It's known as a steel guitarist's paradise, and you were able to take lessons from DeWitt Scott, who was known as Scotty. What did he bring to the table for you as a kid?
He sold me my first steel, that professional right there, and that was my first lesson. When we got back from Illinois or Indiana, I think it was Illinois, where we went to pick it up, I brought it back, and I was so stoked about having it. I set it up in the shop, and he gave me my first lesson. Then he gave me, I think, two more 30-minute lessons. He said, that's all I've got. You know, he said, you know, on adventure. So I took some lessons from Wally Murphy. But, yeah, he started me out on the thing and sold me my first pedal steel and my Showbed volume pedal. I still got it. Still works, too.
Another early influence, and you've mentioned him a little bit earlier, was Shot Jackson, who instrumental in Showbud. What's a Showbud and what's a Shot Jackson?
Well, Shot Jackson was a man that helped more people probably in the music business. And you didn't have to be playing a Showbud, you know, whatever guitar you play, but he helped so many people. And he owned Showbud. Him and Buddy Evans, of course, started the company out. But Shot, when I was, I've been playing about seven or 8 months, and I did the steel guitar convention in St. Louis. Seemed like it might have been a different hotel, but then what they ended up there at the Chase Plaza or whatever. But I played a real quick set, 20 minutes or something, and Shot offered to give me build me a guitar because I was playing a Showbud professional, and he said, "I'll build you any guitar you want." So he gave me my second Showbud when I was 12 years old, and to represent the company. And he was always good to me, and like a father in many ways. And him and Johnny Cox, I took a job with the Singing Rambos. Johnny Cox had been playing steel with the gospel group, the Singing Rambos, and yeah, that's me and Dumplin right there. Look at the picture. Dumplin's got his arms folded. I never had my arms folded like that, but I'm trying to be like him. Got my arms folded. But he had gone to work with Jim Ed Brown. He had left the Rambos, and so between him and Shot Jackson's recommendation, I got the gig with the Rambos without them ever hearing me. And I went out and played, toured with them for about 6 or 7 months. My first Nashville Road gig.
So as you integrate yourself into the professional music scene, you wind up in Memphis, which is not known as a steel guitar town. Memphis is known for many things, steel guitar not being one of those things. What was the scene like, and how was Chip's Moman essential to you becoming a real deal professional musician?
Well, Chip's, it was Chip's and Reggie's words. I had met Chips when I was a kid. And
by Reggie, you mean there, Reggie Young.
Reggie Young, yeah. And Jenny Young's here tonight. Where you at, Jenny? And Reggie Jr.'s here, and his wife, and Jesse Noble. I got so many people here. I'd met those guys at American when I was young, but then Chips came back to Memphis and had it was a bad publicized deal in Memphis. You know, he came back there. The city rolled the red carpet out for him and gave him financing for a studio and everything. He built a really nice studio. And when he came back, I started working with him and at his studio. And so we did the Highwaymen albums, you know. And so, and that was Chips that put all them together. And so he used me on those records and it was him and Reggie Young that actually convinced me that I should move to Nashville. And it was the greatest move I ever made in my life. It really was. Reggie always said that Memphis was a producer's town and Nashville was a musician's town. And I understood what he said after that, because you'd play a session, four songs all week long in Memphis, and you'd make one session. You know, they didn't honor the 3-hour thing, you know. It could be 3 years, and so that was, and here it was just a totally different vibe, you know. It was the union was much better, and Reggie told me, he said, "You'll stumble upon more work here," and I got to working with Reggie real close with the Highwaymen, and on the first tour, we were sitting in the back of the bus. That's me and Reggie and J.R. Cobb, and Reggie was my best friend. He really was, and there's nobody that means any more to me. And the greatest guitar player that ever lived, tone, everything, and probably the greatest man, too, that I ever met. I miss him a whole lot, so much. But he said, "Why do you still?" You know, he's on the first Highwaymen tour. So we did this Highwaymen records, and so they put the tour together.
Now, who in the world were the Highwaymen?
Michael rowed the boat ashore. No. It's Waylon, Willie, John R. Cash, and Chris Christopherson.
Yeah.
And you are, I mean, you were known among people who knew you. You were kind of locally famous as somebody who was a prodigy, but you weren't used to hanging with the likes of these kind of legends. Were you scared to death when you started working with them?
Not really. Johnny Cash was the only one that, because when I was a kid, I had every album of Johnny's, and I would stand in the mirror, wear black, and have my mama's guitar on, and she had a strap that lock here because he wore the strap up here. I'd take a belt, wrap it around the neck, and I'd try to lower my voice, "Hello, I'm Johnny Cash." And I'd watch the TV show with the two trains, you know, running each other in front. And so I really wanted to be John, so I was most intimidated. I would get nervous every time he'd try to talk to me. But no, I hadn't. One of the biggest artists I had hung out with was Johnny Paycheck, and I got busted with him. I mean, bad choices. We all make them. But I never played a gig with him. Well, we played at the club. I played for like 2 weeks, and we were up the whole time. And he hired me to go to Miami and play with him at some festival. So he called here and called his band leader. Big Jim Murphy had just left him, and he couldn't get a bus out of Nashville because he owed people money. And so my parents had a bus company in Memphis, had some Silver Eagle buses. And so he came to Memphis to rent a bus from it, and me and him kind of hooked up and hung out for a couple of weeks, hung out and up. And so I packed my stuff. I quit my job. He hired me to play. He called and said, fire the steel player, whoever that is. I'm going to bring my steel player from Memphis. And we're going to get on the bus there in Memphis to go to Nashville and then going down to Miami. Well, we left the club that night, and blue lights went on everywhere. And needless to say, I spent the night in jail on paycheck, went on to Miami and played without a steel. I mean, paycheck was probably one of the biggest artists I'd work with. Charlie Rich, of course, too. I mean, you know, I worked with him. He's pretty big. And Jerry Lee, I'd worked with some big guys, but the Highwayman was the biggest thing, you know.
Yeah. Mm. And you're on stages with them going all over the place, big arenas. I think we've got some video of you playing with the Highwaymen, and in case anybody thinks you're lying.
Do I have a flock of seagulls hairdo?
Let's see.
So tell me one more time, so I'll understand. Oh, you sure ain't done it this way. Then old Hank really do it this way. Take it on.
Flock of seagulls. That was the greatest band that you could ever ask to play with, too. I mean, it was the American Rhythm Section with Mickey Raphael. And Bonnie Garner's here, too. She was our tour manager in Bon Bon. And she came out to see me. Anyway, that was the greatest band. The American Rhythm Section and all those players and those four guys. Sometimes I would literally pinch myself on stage, you know, just to stay awake. No, just to... because it's like a dream, you know, when you're looking at Chris Christopherson's butt and Johnny Cash's butt and Waylon's butt. And Willie's butt was way down here, but I could still see it. It sounds like I looked like a lot of men's butts, didn't it? I did. But when you look at it and you turn around, and you know, Chris would come back here and make faces. Johnny Cash hated steel. And he would come back here, and when I'd be, you know, in his songs like Folsom Prison stuff, I'd be acting like I'm playing, and I'd be just like strumming rhythm on the steel just open, you know. And he'd turn around and go, and you'd do that sound like that. Back up. But it was one of the highlights of my life.
What is the gig like? What are you supposed to do on stage when you are a supporting player with legendary musicians? Are you supposed to ham it up? Are you supposed to play whatever was on the record? How are you supposed to act?
We did the songs, the signature licks that needed to be done. Like when Highwayman, you know, Reggie did that flanger lick. Like he played great signature licks on everything he ever played on. But we had freedom too to do what we wanted to. But it wasn't showtime. It wasn't like when I was with Stapleton, we'd do Might As Well Get Stoned, and I would stand up at the steel, you know, and play a wild, crazy. What was talk about? Might As Well Get Stoned, you know. So play a wild solo at the end of it.
Stapleton, you're talking about Chris Stapleton.
Yeah, Chris. I'm sorry, I jumped there. But yeah, it was a great show. Those four guys controlled it, but we had freedom, and it was some great music, really great music.
Yeah. You were buddies with those folks, and are buddies with the ones that remain, but you and Waylon Jennings forged a very tight relationship. I've had the experience in my life of becoming friends with some heroes, including Lloyd Green. What
Me
was
too.
That like for you to try to interact on a human level with somebody whose music you'd grown up listening to and loving?
Ralph Mooney was another strong influence. I loved Ralph. And so I really started listening to Waylon, that's me and Ralph, when I was 11 years old. And I had a black wig on, because I let a teacher at school cut my hair, and it was real short. My mother said, "You are an entertainer, you can have short hair." So she went out and bought this black wig and made me wear it. I swear, look, I'm 11 years old here. Yeah, I messed up a while ago, too. I started playing pedal steel when I was 11. I showed up at 12. Anyway, I was 11 here and had that black wig on. Lord, Lord. But I was, anyway, so I loved Waylon, and I got to listen to him because of Ralph.
Do you still have that wig?
The black wig?
Because we would like that for our collection here at the Country Music Hall of
Fame.
Boy,
yeah. It might need to be washed, you know. How about that shirt, though? Somebody made that shirt for me. I don't know. But anyway, waited that night. He said, "I like that shirt, Hoss." He said, "I'll trade you this coat for it." And I'm thinking, "Oh, that's cool." Richie was there that night. And he said, "I'll trade you this coat." And he said, "But I got to get something out of the pocket." and I think he got thinking about it real quick. He said, "Well, you just keep your shirt on." But anyway, yeah, and I just love my dad would, you know, my dad would always say, "You got to play with conviction and drive when you're playing anything, what he called driving, that driving beat." And I remember when Hank would come on one of those songs, he would turn the radio up and say, "Listen right there, there's the drive." It was Richie, you know, that kick drum and stuff, and that sound they created, which was so cool. But Waylon started on to me when I, you know, about the second Highwayman tour, because Mooney had been gone. He said, "Why don't you come out and play some gigs with me?" And I had moved to Nashville to do sessions. He waited until I moved to Nashville, and I had moved to Nashville to do sessions and still do the Highwayman gig. We didn't tour a lot, maybe once or twice a year, you know, short tours. So anyway, he and I said, I didn't feel right because I didn't talk to Moon about it, you know, so I'd say, well, you know, maybe I'll do it sometime. And he kept bringing it up. So finally, I think we were in Vegas one time, and he said about 2 days in a row, he said, well, what are you going to do? You going to come play some? I said, let me think about it. So I called Mooney, and he said, what you want now, kid? And I said, well, Mr. Mooney, said, you know, Waylon's offering. He said, well, I knew it was going to happen. He said, go ahead. I'm through with the old fart. And anyway, I went back and told Waylon I felt comfortable about it, you know. And so I went back and took the job with Waylon. And that came from working with the highwaymen and stuff. But Mooney and Waylon, you know, didn't talk a lot for a while. And
they got crossways.
They got crossways for a minute. And it broke my heart. It really did, because I loved both of them very much. I loved Mooney already, but when I got to know Waylon, you know, he was family, so they had a little falling out, and Waylon didn't talk about it a lot in front of me, and he knew that I didn't like him talking bad about me, which he didn't do a lot anyway. You know, he just wouldn't talk really. So it was kind of a subject we didn't bring up a lot. And I tried a couple of times, and it didn't work. And I'd see Mooney at the Steel Guitar Convention in St. Louis. He'd say, tell Carter, Barney, and Miss Jessie, and Richie, and Reggie, and Waylon. Reggie. I said, hi. I said, aren't you forgetting somebody? He said, no, I ain't forgetting nobody. And so that happened several years, two or three years. And so one time we went through that whole thing again, and I hugged his neck. I said, I'm gonna go on. This was like a Sunday afternoon when the Steel Guitar Show was over. And I walked away, and I heard a voice say, tell the old fart. I said, hi, and I love him. And I said, turn, I said, what did you say? He said, I ain't saying it again. You heard me. So I said, here's an open door, and something that I had been really praying for and wanting in my heart to see is those two guys, because they were brothers, and they made some great music along with Richie that, you know, those three guys together created the whole element, and it was equal parts of all three of them. You know, Richie especially, you know, and Waylon, and with the rhythm thing, and then but Moon, man, it was just so that bite, that fire he had. Waylon said it was like piercing eras, the way that his tone was bright and the way he would do it, and that's what turned him on, because he asked Moon to go work with him several times before Moon finally took the gig. So anyway, I said, well, here's the opportunity. So Waylon's working in my studio the next Monday, doing something, putting a vocal on something. And so he's sitting on my couch, we're finished. I said, well, I got to tell you something. Somebody said, tell the old fart that he loved you. And he said, well, it has to be Moon, because you just got back from the Steel Guitar Convention. And he said, well, it's about damn time. And I said, well, I'll tell you what it's time for. I think it's time for you guys to speak, you know, and end this thing, because I love you both a lot, and you're like brothers, you know. Something, and I was concerned something was going to happen to one of them, you know, and the other would be stuck here. And so anyway, and he said, you're crossing a line. And that's the toughest I think he ever spoke to me when he said that, because it kind of crushed me a little bit. I said, I don't really care, you know. I said, this has really mean something to my heart. I said, this is much more important than just the music, you know. I said, I think it'd be great, because he's reached out. And so he left the studio kind of pissed off at me. And by the time he got back to his house in Franklin, Brentwood, he called me on the cell phone. He said, I've been thinking about it. You're right. He said, set it up. Anyway, we played Houston at Richie, where was it? There was it... The amphitheater in Houston. Woodland. And it was the perfect show. Somebody drove Moody there, and I got there a day early where we could get all the drinking out of the way, you know, because I said, you know, Ralph, you know, you need to stay. He said, oh, don't worry, I'm gonna stay straight. We're going to drink coffee. Boy, did we drink coffee. But the first night, we went a day early and got all the drinking out of the way, which was hard. And then the coffee the next day. So it was a perfect show, because it had Willie, David Allen Coe, John Anderson, Jerry Jeff Walker, everybody, Hank the Third, everybody was on it. It was a like a big outlaw show just all day long. And so Moody came and did sound check, set his steel beside mine. And so we did a couple songs, and then Waylon did a medley of Amanda and a couple more years. So I picked the mandolin up on my tech would hand me the mandolin for a couple more years. And I said, that's the time, just plug Moody Steel in my amp. And I turned it over to Moody and I left the stage. And they played seven, eight or nine songs. I've got it in Pro Tools and got the DAT from the show. But it was the greatest thing. When Waylon and Moody saw each other, they both hugged necks. Waylon was walking with a cane. And it was a touching moment, you know. But it was so, Richie, wasn't it great? Wasn't it great? Except when Moody jumped the intro on Rainy Day One, but it's funny because you can hear you laugh on the DAT, you know. But it's magical. I listen to it now, I get teary eyed. Well, after the gig was over with, I sat over cried, literally, I did. And I'm not saying that I did this. I was just a conduit because I've been praying for God to do this, to resolve the differences, and it happened. And it wasn't because of me. You know, I was diligent. I just wanted to see it happen, and I was just a conduit. But that meant more to me than anything I've ever done musically, really, because that was more important. And so we got through the gig, and I was saying goodbye to Moody, hugged his neck downstairs. And Moody wasn't to hug a lot of men, but he figured out that I was going to hug him anyway. And so he hugged, and he looked at me, and his eyes was teary. He said, "You reunited two brothers tonight." And I said, "No, God did it. I'm just a conduit." But that was the greatest thing in my life I've ever seen. He said, "Well," he said, "it's a special time." So I got back. I hugged his neck, said goodbye to him. And so the next, I got back to my room, and it was a message from Jesse. Said, "Waylon wants to see you after the gig." I said, "Uh-oh." So I went to the suite. I called him. He was still up waiting for me. So I went up there, and he said just about word for word the same thing. You know, he stood up, got out of his lazy boy chair in the suite, and stood up, hugged my neck. And he said "You reunited." And he even says something about that on the thing. Said, "It's good to be reunited with my brother." We said we I think he says, how many years we worked together, Moon? And Moon said, "Too many," you know. And Waylon says things like, "He was my hero then and he's my hero now," and he was mine too, you know. So and the day that Waylon passed, I stayed on the phone with Moon, well, probably four different times, I believe. We spoke for at least an hour or two each time, you know. And that just meant a lot to me. And it was so good to see that happen, because that's such history. The outlaw thing, the whole outlaw thing was created by those three guys, yeah. Richie, Waylon, and Moon. I feel like, you know, it was Richie and Waylon, then Moon kind of joined in. But it was an important part.
I think that's an important lesson in that you're a steel player and you're mending fences between Waylon and another steel player that he had played with for years. And people sometimes assume that music is a competition between players. It's not that way.
It's helping people out, helping each other out, building each other up. You know, there's a few, but they're not the ones that last, that get competitive or whatever. I mean, maybe they do last. I don't know, but that's not the way I'd rather. Matter of fact, I said something to Waylon. I said, "Well, when do you want this to happen again?" He said, "We'll talk about that later." You know, because it was really hard to get everything in order. You know, but it was such history to me. Reggie too. We and him stood over and watched them the first time they hugged, you know, they went 11 years without saying a word to each other. Jeez.
Now, Waylon died in 2002, leaving you with a hole in your heart and also leaving you with some special recordings and some instructions. Tell me about that, the going down rocking.
Yeah, he came out to my studio and he said, I want to book your studio. He called me and I said, okay, what are you doing? I didn't know if it was going to be, he wanted just to do some songwriter things, because it wasn't going to be with a band, just him by himself. And so he said, I want you to record. I didn't know if it would go straight to CD or that, if you're just trying to do some reference songwriter things for publishing company. Or he said, no, I want to record on multi-track because I want you to finish it one day. And I didn't really know what that means. So I don't know what, we go in and start cutting these songs. And of course, going down rocking, we were already playing with the Waymore's Blues Band, Richie and Barney Carter's here from that band too. And where you at? Where's the spotlight? There's not one. Okay. You bring your own light. There they are right there. They're family. So anyway, we were already playing some of these songs, so we started cutting them. Then he did Bell of the Ball. And I said, well, that's wild. He's doing that song and revisiting it, you know. And then he did a couple songs that Richie remembers where he got it from back in Phoenix. I'm drawing a blank. Anyway, it's a waltz. and Jesse didn't, there was no publishing information. Waylon wrote it, I knew that, but I should have taken half writers, not really. But nobody knew he'd wrote this thing except Richie remembers where he got it from, where he got the idea from, because he was working, it was an old idea. Went out of my way to go get out of my mind or something. I went out of your way to get out of your mind. Anyway, it made an impression on me, you can tell. So, no, it was a great song, it really was. So he's doing all these songs, and so we're flying out a couple of weeks later to get them all done. A couple of things, the keys were too high. He said, let me know if you think they're too high. And so we come back and redid the ones, three or four, three of them, in lower keys, and so got those done. So a couple of weeks later, we're at the airport, and I said, Hoss, what do you want to do with these things? He said, I want you to finish them one day. And so I still never thought about it. I just kept the tapes put up. He passed away, and I called the office and said something about these tapes, you know, are here, probably his last recordings. And Nikki got back with me and said, those are yours, you know. And so I made Jesse my partner. Is that me? No.
Yeah, it's you.
Oh, okay. So, it's not me. Somebody, okay. So, I got this, so I called and she said, so I didn't think of anything about it because I didn't want to mess with him. It was too soon. Okay, so.
It's all done now.
I know.
It's okay.
Good deal. So, anyway, about 10 years later, I get those tapes out and start listening to them and revisit them. Because it felt like the right time. I didn't really think about it until then. And we got everybody together, and Richie and Barney and Carter and Reggie, and just some of the folks, you know, and finished those things. But we kind of approached it with what would Waylon do. Nobody told anybody what to do, you know, just because Waylon never really told us what to do. We just played till he smiled, you know, and because he would never even, he'd say, Reggie, Robby, y'all play it, or Reggie, play the solo, or whatever, and Robby, whatever, and he didn't say what order or whatever. We'd always work that out, and when we'd see him smile, I think that was the whole concept of his bands, you know. He said his mic, like Carter's mic, was even with his. And we get a new production manager, and they said, their background singers' mics back a little bit, wait them be out front, and he'd say, no, we're a band. And he'd line up all those singers up front. I said, well, why ain't I up front then? No. I was too big. And so, yeah, he had that band concept, especially with that last band, too. It was
You play until Waylon smiles. That might take 6-7 years sometimes.
I'm sorry, I missed that. I was looking right through you.
I said you play until Waylon smiles. It might take 6-7 years sometimes. You know.
No, 6 or 7 minutes.
Okay. Hey, I think we have a little bit of footage from the making of that album. Can we see that? Going Down Rockin'?
Vagabond dreamer, rhymer and singer of song, singing to no one and nowhere to really belong. I met a beautiful...
So Waylon calls and says, I want to cut some tracks at your studio. Just me and acoustic guitar. And so I ask if these songwriter reference tapes, and do you want to do them straight to the DAT machine or CD, and, or do you want to do it on the multitrack or get overdubbed? He said, I want you to overdub on it. So I got prepared for that. We did the tracks. And then after completing his vocals and guitar, we got ready 2 or 3 weeks later to fly out for a weekend gig or something at the Nashville airport. And I was sitting beside him. I said, oh, by the way, what's the deadline on finishing these tracks? And he said, there is no deadline. Just finish them one day. So after Waylon passed away in 2002, I waited a week or two, and I was at my studio doing something. I opened the tape closet, and I see the tapes up there with his name on them. And every time I'd open the tape closet and see those tapes, I'd say, well, you know, I still have that appointment. I would think what he said, you finish them one day. But then I would say, I'm not ready yet. Because I would always be filled with pain from missing him. And it got to a point to where I felt like I could deal with him, you know, put him on. So I've stuck him on the 24-track machine and listened to him. And I started thinking about the opportunity it would be to get everybody together again. That was the most important thing to me, is to have the good feeling of his presence again. And that's what everybody said that was involved. Even people that didn't know Waylon said they felt his presence.
Let me say something real quick. This track was made so special by Jenny Young and Reggie Young. There were, at the end of it, the band stops and Waylon starts playing the thumb rhythm. Billy Joe Walker played acoustic on the rest of the song because I put all those chords in it. At the end of it, I took the part where Waylon's direct signal and just had him slinging that thumb. And, then Reggie started playing this little thing at the end of it. And I said, keep it going, just keep it going. You know, I had the clip going, just keep it going. And then I put that, moved it up to the front, and Jenny come in and added these two beautiful cello parts. I mean, it's just, and things like that happened. That was one take that wasn't meant to be, you know, and it was just so magical. And then, like, I Do Believe is on there, where everybody for the hearts in it, and you can feel that. You know, that's where you can feel more so than anything else, is you really know that everybody is playing from the heart and soul, you know, but. It's good stuff. Yeah. Not because I did it, but everybody else. Still sucks.
Now, you spent so many years with Waylon in the studio and on stage. How do you go from working with a master like that to answering the phone and saying, yeah, I can be at so-and-so's session on Tuesday morning at 10 a.m.? How do you adjust your playing to deal with different people and different sensibilities?
I don't know how much I changed my style. I know with Waylon, I played a certain style, and it wasn't so much Moon, because he told me one time, when I first went to work with him, I was playing a lot of stuff, and he called me on the bus after a couple of weeks, and said, I'm already in trouble. And he said, are you playing trying to play like Moon? I said, yes, sir. He said, I want you to play your stuff. And I said, well, if you let me play Rainy Day Woman like Mooney, I'll play the rest of the stuff like I want it to. And that's the deal we made, really. So, but it was still a style that was kind of patterned after Moon. But the ability to change different artist is called Keeping the Kids from Eating Putty Out of the Windows. You know, feeding the kids, feeding the family. And I don't really conform. I mean, you hear a song a certain way, and then if you got a certain sound, if you develop a certain sound with the artist, you need to stick with that kind of sound. But an artist wants to grow too, you know, with producers. Hopefully Artist Records gets better and better. With each LP they do, or not LP anymore, but CD, whatever, project. You know, they all want to progress together, you know, for each record to be better. And so they can't stay the same, but then there's this kind of signature sound that needs to go along with it too. So you just have to weigh all that stuff out. And if somebody says, hey, man, you've played on 3 of my albums and I hate everything you've played, then you probably want to change it.
Yeah. Now, Robby, this answer may require a bit of immodesty, but what is it about your steel playing that makes people like the Dixie Chicks and Jim Lauderdale, artists who rely on significant steel guitar, what is it about your playing that makes them want to call on you?
We're all just players. We're all different. You know, Lloyd Green's one of the greatest. Sonny Garish is one of the greatest. Emmons, you know. Everybody... But see, it goes back to the argument of Buddy Emmons and Jimmy Day. You know, those two guys gave us everything. They really did. They started out giving us everything from their heart of the instrument. They played totally different, you know. But, you know, so you look at all these great players, and I'm not putting myself in the league with them. I'm just saying we're all just steel players, and we all have our own thing that we do, bring to the table. I think maybe one of mine is that I grew up in an R&B town, and I, you know, where steel wasn't as popular. And I bring a little bit of that, you know, not that I'm an R&B steel player, but I did do that country rhythm and blues project, and I think that's one thing that Don was made reference to one time, is that the fact that I'm from Memphis, you know, it's just different, you know. That's why we have different steel players. You know, that's why there's a steel guitar section in the union book for people to look in, you know, and get the number of who they want to call.
There's less and less significant steel guitar on the radio these days. Probably.
Amen.
What's that?
Amen.
Yeah. I mean, probably Lloyd Green's solo on Alan Jackson's Remember When was the last, like, 16-bar steel solo that meant
something.
Wasn't
that the only one?
That was a hit. Yeah. Does that disappoint you? Does that make you feel like a dinosaur?
No. There's a place for all of it. You know, there's all kinds of genres of music. Because I don't prefer a certain genre of music, some of the newer stuff I don't prefer. That don't mean it's bad. There's a place for it. Somebody likes it. Somebody's been, you know, brainwashed or fed this music so much. I don't mean brainwashed. That's a terrible word. Amen, right? Really, I'll tell it like it is. They've been force-fed so much from corporate, you know, and they play the same 15 songs, and I think Keeper of the Flame is one of those songs. But, I mean, that's not our Keeper of the... whatever song is, but... they play the same 15 songs, but they only play certain things on the radio. Hey, Stapleton's going on 5 million on the Traveler album,
right,
that I played on. And he's had a very successful career in spite of radio, because radio, I don't know if they even play him now or not a lot.
Rarely. And that's the thing. You've been able to kind of turn and pivot and been an important part of records that have done incredibly well that haven't been featured on the radio, and working with people like Stapleton and Sturgill Simpson, working a lot with Dave Cobb at RCA Studio.
I'm a blessed man. I really am. I'm a blessed man. That I'm just another steel player, really, in my heart. And I love playing with those guys, you know, but I'm blessed. for those situations like that. I'm not the reason those records are as hot, but it's a combination of everything. You know, Dave Cobb is he here? Okay, I'll mark that down.
Yeah.
But Dave, I work for Dave a lot, and Lloyd works for Dave. You know, and Dave loves Lloyd's playing too. You know, when I was in the hospital or something, he played with Colter Wall's great. There's enough work for all of us. But I've been blessed for those things like that. I called the Stapleton album. I'm the only one. And I told Dave Cobb after tracking most of it, I said, this album is going to be really special. It's going to surprise you and the Stapletons. And Chris and Morgan was in the control room when I said it at RCAA over there. And Dave said, if I had them to come out here and would you tell them the same thing? I said, yeah. So they called him out there, and I said, it's special. So when the album was released, it did good. But then after the CMA with Justin Timberlake, it did a whole lot better immediately. And so anytime Chris would go do the Grammys or something, he would always say, well, you need to interview Robby Turner because he's the only one that called the album. And I did call it. Yeah, I mean, I felt like it. I had that feeling about it, you know, and that's very rare that happens. So.
I wanted to ask you.
The only time in my life I've ever been right.
I'm hoping my time comes next week. I wanted to ask you, as we talked about earlier, so many steel players, playing the steel guitar requires such concentration that most people look like, while they're playing it, looks like they're doing. They look like they're doing something very, very difficult, and they're just, you know, everybody else is bopping around on stage, and they are just focused in.
Peter,
do
you play steel?
What's that?
Do you play steel?
I did for 3 months, and then I was angry at everything and everyone, and yeah, I traded
for another 3 years
for another guitar.
So you know how complicated it really is, the coordination, all that stuff is involved.
Yeah, it's...
But it's a desire of the heart, too. If you really, really want to play that instrument, but that's the problem with a lot of people. They think they can sit down at it just like guitar. They can sit down and, hey, I can whoop something. I'm a guitar player. I can do that. And they pack it up or get rid of it and never play it again because it's discouraging because it's complicated. But once you realize... you know, that it's that and get past that and have a desire to a heart to play it. It's not that bad, is it, Lloyd?
Well, that's
he's not going to agree with me.
That's where my heartaches began. But anyway, what I was leading to is on stage, you were talking a moment ago about how you would get on stage like with Chris Stapleton, and you would stand up at the steel and kind of shake it around, and you actually smile when you play sometimes, which is something that I've never seen a steel guitar player do. I've seen Lloyd after a solo look up and smile,
I smile when Lloyd plays a solo.
Yeah. But do you remember when you began actually playing with kind of physical expression in addition to your musical expression?
Steel players are known for making faces. I mean, they are. And I've been known to make some faces, ugly ones, smile or whatever. But the stand-up thing happened. I used to go sit in with a really rock group. They did Freebird, our favorite song, you know, some Skitter songs. And I would go sit in with them. And they played an after-hours gig. And I would stand up and play solos. And people would bring beer bottles up, you know, and I'd play slide with a beer bottle. And so I've done that before when I was younger, and I just thought the song's about might as well get stoned, you know, and I got a good long solo at the end. And so I just, for the first time I went out with them, the first night I played with them, I just stood up. Maybe I was trying to leave. No. No.
I want to show, there's a great clip from the David Letterman show with you playing with Chris and Morgan Stapleton on Traveler, and it ends with David Letterman talking to you and kind of wondering about the steel. And I think we'll close on
that.
This
was my first thing after I played on Stapleton's album. He asked me to go do Letterman with him, and I did a record release party later in the week there in New York with Stapleton. But I felt kind of strange about that. But Dave has done that with other steel players, talk about it being a helicopter. He's fascinated with the steel guitar, always was. And Sid played, guitar player that played a little steel, you know, had a single neck steel and played every now and then on the show. But my first gig was Stapleton, and Dave comes right over to me first, you know, and I'm going, it's probably my last, you know. But, no, Dave, and I've been on there. Dave talked to me after the show, because that was when he was getting off, and he said, I remember you being on here with Waylon and Willie, and they were two of my favorite guests of all times to have on here.
Wow. And, how cold was it in the studio that day?
I lost three nipples. I've still got one. It's cold. I mean, I tell you what, it's really cold. I'm sorry, I should have said that. Should I not said that? Really, come on. No, I'm being honest. I'm not sure where the last one is. It is. It's cold in there. But there, when I took a metal body dobro in there, you know, it was metal body, and I had a short sleeve shirt on, that's when I realized how cold it was.
Yeah.
My arm hit that thing, and when I raised up, the whole dobro came up. It was stuck to my arm. Dave came over and shook my, and I was trying to get my arm off the door to shake his hand.
It's the weirdest thing. That was the cold. He mandated it to be that cold. 54? No, I don't. I think it was colder than that. The one time I got to play bass for somebody on that show, I remember the band showed up that morning, and we were singing, and we could see our breath while we were rehearsing. And Letterman just likes it cold, but he was warm to you. And so let's see Robby Turner playing Traveler with Chris Stapleton.
I'm just a traveler on this earth. Shut my heart behind the pocket of my shirt. I just keep rolling till I'm in the dirt, 'cause I'm a traveler.
Mrs. Stapleton,
yeah.
Pleasure to have you here. What's your name?
Morgan.
Morgan, beautiful. Hey, Chris, how are you? Fantastic. That's tremendous. That's amazing. It's like flying a helicopter, isn't it? Whoa, buddy. That's good. We got to get one of those, Paul. I want one.
You and
he
me.
Didn't say
Chris
that.
Stapleton,
10 years
ladies
earlier,
gentlemen, traveler.
Yeah. He wasted his last week in programming. You know, I could have had a great gig. You know. You know, something else I need to say, I was thinking still. Jeff Surratt, are you here somewhere? Jeff and Gloria Surratt, they build Show Pro steel guitars, and they have supported me in so many ways and helped me. He's come to sessions when I've had problems breaking the strings, volume pedals, pickups going bad before the session. Nothing to do with Show Pro, different pickups. But, you know, one time I was out there changing strings, and my guitar sounds dull or my ears are gone. And so Jeff came over there before, you know, it was like 8 o'clock in the morning and puts it. But they have supported me so much. Give Show Pros Steel Guitars a round of applause. They're the best.
Y'all, thank you so much for being here. Robby, thank you for giving of your time and telling us some of your stories, and it's just such a pleasure to have you here. It's a wonderful thing for the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum to bring you in and let folks in on some of your secrets. Robby Turner, Nashville Cat, thank you so much.